So we're in John 12, 12 through 26. We're talking about the triumphal entry. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the feast. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me." That's the end.
So, important passage. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem, and people are starting to figure out that he's somebody. He's not just a normal guy. They're following him. And so as he's coming in Jerusalem, this is Palm Sunday. We call it Palm Sunday because this is the day that Jesus came in Jerusalem and people threw palm branches down and in front of him. And the people don't really know what's about to happen, but they know something is about to happen. And we can look through the course of our history and we can look back at points in time where you knew something was about to happen. Like when Lee Harvey Oswald is on TV and he's in the basement of the courthouse and he's being led out of the courthouse and everybody's watching this, and you know something is about to happen, but you don't know what is about to happen. And then Jack Ruby jumps out and shoots him and kills him on live TV. This is one of those moments. These people are watching this thing happen. They know something is about to happen, but they have no idea what it is. Even when Jesus says, a grain of wheat that falls on the ground, in order for it to produce fruit, it has to die first. And they still don't necessarily fully understand what is about to happen. But Jesus is on his way into Jerusalem, and this is Sunday. Friday, he dies. And this is the last time he's coming into Jerusalem. And if we're watching a movie, this is the pivotal scene that happens right before the final battle scene. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem to confront the Pharisees. He's coming in there to have the final confrontation with them that is going to lead to his death. This is the most pivotal scene when we were looking through this weekend. Something is about to happen. Unfortunately, we know what it is because we've read the Bible, right? They didn't. So as we're going to go through today, we're going to continue to pick up on four different scenes that are ultimately leading to what happens. Trying to look at it from their perspective of the people who know something is about to happen, but don't quite know what it is that's about to happen.
For our second reading today, we're going to read out of John 13, 1 through 20. Jesus washes his disciples' feet. It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into the basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, you are going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "do not just wash my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "A person who has a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew that there was going to be one to betray him, and that is why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to the place. "Do you understand that I have done what I have done for you?" he had said to them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I do for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." And then here's Jesus starts to predict his betrayal. "I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares my bread has lifted up his heel against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am he. I tell you the truth, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me."
So, kind of a odd reading for communion, to me, how there's no breaking of the bread and sharing of the blood. But this is the ultimate sign of communion. Jesus bending down and washing the feet of the disciples. For centuries, millennia, people brought their sacrifices to God, and it didn't seem to matter. They would make a sacrifice, they would do something wrong, they would make a sacrifice to God to get absolution for what they did, and then they would just go do it again. Because I can do whatever I want to do, it doesn't matter, because I can just make a sacrifice and then on Sunday and be forgiven. And so it wasn't doing what it had intended to do. And so Jesus is saying, okay, as God, I will be the sacrifice to you. And so Jesus is standing there washing the feet of Peter. Peter's saying, "Wait, whoa, 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 this is backwards." And Jesus is saying, "No, it's not. I am sacrificing for you." So as we have today the bread and the wine, and Jesus saying the words, "Do you not know what I've done? You call me teacher and Lord, and here you are. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you also to wash one another's. For I give you an example that you should do as I do." Jesus Christ broke his body for the betterment of the body. Jesus Christ shed his blood for the betterment of the body. We don't come receive these elements to be absolved for the things that we have done wrong. We've come and receive these elements so we can ask ourselves, how can I be like Jesus? How can I break my body for the betterment of the body? How can I shed my blood for the betterment of the body? How can I be a sacrifice to my neighbor? As Jesus sacrificed himself for me, what sacrifices can I make for those around me? Once again, I don't think he's telling you to go nail yourself to a cross. But what can we sacrifice to help our loved ones to know that they are loved? How can we give and demonstrate the example of Jesus Christ through the deeds of which he did? I'm not going to have you all take off your shoes, because some of you, I'm sure Ryan's probably... But... I know Ryan gets his mani-pedis on a regular basis. His feet are... It was not about literally washing each other's feet, but how can we better serve each other? And not just those who are sitting in here in church. How can we better serve our literal neighbors, our figurative neighbors, our co-workers, our friends, our family members?
This reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 18, verses 3 through 11. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So, for me, this is one of the most, and I always say that, and I realize it's hyperbole, but one of the passages has to be the most significant passage. One of them, I say they all are, but this one is just, there's a lot of power in it. I don't know if we fully recognize that. It says when Judas received a Roman cohort. A Roman cohort was a Roman battalion, which is 600 men. So 600 soldiers. Now, not only did he have 600 soldiers from Rome, okay, he had the officers of the chief priests and the Pharisees. So the police, the chief priests and the Pharisees' police force, and a Roman cohort. So we're looking like 1,000 men. Okay? So imagine this. And this is going to be hard for us to imagine. Imagine the religious institution of America and the American government teaming up to kill one person. That's what we have here. We have the religious institution banding together with the government system because they know that this one person is going to overthrow both. So they show up with 1,000 men to arrest him. And Jesus says, "Who are you looking for?" And they say, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he says, "I am he." And 1,000 men carrying pitchforks and torches and whatever other weapons. I think I made pitchforks up. But you know what I mean. You just imagine that this angry mob with a torch in one hand, pitchfork in the other. They're coming for him. 1,000 of them. And he says, "I am he." And they all are just knocked out. He didn't touch him. He didn't have a single weapon, but "I am he." And they were instantly defeated. 1,000 men defeated on the ground, knocked out with three words. And Jesus says, so who is it you were looking for? And then, in verse 12, so the Roman cohort and the commander and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. How does that happen? How do we get from 1,000 men being knocked out with three words to Jesus being bound up and arrested and led away? How does that happen if Jesus doesn't let it happen? If Jesus doesn't say, allow me to place myself in the hands of you sinners. God in the hands of angry sinners. You can't bound me up on your own. You can't arrest me on your own. You have 1,000 men and weapons. I have no weapons in three words and I defeated you. Go ahead, get up, dust yourself off, and take me away. I dare you. I dare you to arrest me. I dare you to mock me. I dare you to kill me. Because these things that you're going to proclaim as your victory will be your defeat. You stood there, and we're going to get to it in a few minutes. You stood there with this feeling of victory as I hung on that cross, not knowing that that was the greatest defeat of your life. Think about, for a moment, the plan that Jesus is living out. What he really came to do. This is the climactic scene of the movie. This is the confrontation that we've been waiting for. This is all the people in the garden going, oh, this was what was going to happen. This is it. We just witnessed it. They arrested Jesus. They arrested the guy who came to save them. And Jesus let it happen. There is no other way to explain how he goes from knocking them out with three words to being bound up and led away. This Jesus of Nazareth is more than just a guy. We're talking in Sunday school today how anybody, from my perspective, who denies that there was ever a guy named Jesus from Nazareth doesn't really have a whole lot of credibility. Because we have some pretty solid, I mean, as much as you can have historical evidence from 2,000 years ago, we have pretty solid evidence that there was a guy named Jesus from Nazareth. And it took 1,000 men to arrest him. I'm sorry, if I break the law, 1,000 men aren't going to come kicking in my door to arrest little old me. It took 1,000 men, and he still had to let it happen. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the person of Jesus. And there's greater power in what's going to happen here in a few minutes. Because Jesus has now been arrested. The confrontation has taken place, but the conclusion is yet to come.
You're reading out of the book of John, starting at chapter 19, verse 16 through 30. Then he delivered him to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the place of the skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put on it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, For the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews." But he said, "I am the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also a tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven on the top of in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, then the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" Therefore the soldiers did these things. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to his disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put on it hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit.
It is finished. If only that were true. Jesus hanging there on the cross. So many times our narrative is that as Jesus is on the cross, and some of the Gospels say that Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And it was at that moment that God put all the sins of the world upon Jesus' shoulder, turned his back on Jesus, and walked away. I tend not to believe that's true. I tend to believe that as Jesus was sitting there hanging on that cross, that God was holding the cross up. There's a look on the desktop there. There's a picture, something about Masciato Trinitia. I think I've showed you guys this before. See, I think maybe on the bottom left, you got it? Can you hit the arrow and make it a little bit bigger there? There you go, a little bit bigger. That's how I see the crucifixion. Jesus' hair hanging on the cross, God the Father holding him up, embracing him, and a little wishbone thing that was above him is the Holy Spirit just sitting there above him, just comforting him as he's hanging there on the cross. That's how I understand the crucifixion. When Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He's not asking God why he had forsaken him. He's reminding the Jews in attendance of Psalm 22 that opens up with the Psalm of David, where David says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And then spends the rest of the Psalm illustrating how God had never forsaken him, how God had never abandoned him. And when we understand that the footprints in the sand, the poem, comes out of, from my perspective, comes out of Psalm 22. That's God saying, "I never abandoned you. I never left you. I carried you through your hardest times." And if he's going to do that for us, why wouldn't he do that for Jesus? And so there is God carrying Jesus through his hardest time. The crucifixion carries so much weight. Because these people hate God. These people do not have the Word of God abiding in their heart. And these are the religious members of the nation of Israel. These are the Pharisees and the high priests and the chief priests. They, Jesus says to them in John 5, you do not have the Word of God abiding in your heart. You hate the light because you're living in such darkness. God, as the person of Jesus Christ, wiped them all out with three words. God is saying, your darkness is so dark, I'm going to use it for my ultimate victory. I'm going to place myself in your hands. I'm going to let you mock me. I'm going to let you spit on me. I'm going to let you scourge me. And we've all heard the scourge. It's the whip with the nail on the end of it. So when it and just yanks the skin, the flesh right off your body. I'm going to let you nail me to the cross. I'm going to let you kill me because you hate me so much. And then I'm going to use that hate, the same hate that you had for me that killed me, that's what I'm going to use to save you. I'm going to use your hate for me to save you. Because you don't understand who I am. I've gone through this entire book trying to get you to see who I am. You're constantly thinking that I'm against you, and then you cry out for me, and I come and I save you because I'm not against you. I never was against you. I was always for you. I was always trying to get you to see that your understanding of me was wrong, and you failed to see it. You couldn't see it because of your own blindness and your own darkness, but I don't blame you for that. That's Satan's fault. I will still redeem you. God says, in Jesus, in John 1, it says, Jesus came to enlighten us. And at verse 18, it says, no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, He, Jesus, has explained Him. If we want to understand the character and the nature of God, we look to Jesus, because Jesus spent His lifetime explaining to us the character and the nature of God, but we didn't want to hear it. We said, that's blasphemy. And Jesus says, how can you get up every Sunday and read the Scriptures in your church, but you don't know what the Scriptures say? Because if you knew the Scriptures, you would know that they're prophesying about me and that I am the fulfillment of the prophecy that you're waiting for. The reason why you can't see it in Scripture is because you don't have God abiding in your heart. First Corinthians 'm gonna find it for a minute here. First Corinthians 14:37. If anyone thinks he is a prophet or spiritual, let him recognize that the things I write to you are the Lord's commandments. But if anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. Now Paul's writing to Corinth here. He's saying, look, if you're truly in touch with God, if you're truly a godly person, a spiritual living person, the Holy Spirit's going to confirm in you the things that I'm saying are true. That's what's going on here in the entire Gospel of John. Jesus is saying, if you were truly godly people, if you were truly spiritual people who knew the things that were written about me, you would recognize that I'm the one they were written about. But you're not willing to see it. Because you're so dark, you're so caught up in your process of authority, in your positions of power, in your greed, in your lust for money and power, and all these wonderful things that control you, that you can't see who I am. Let me demonstrate for you who I am. I love you so much. I created all of this with you in mind. I loved you so much that I created you just so I could be with you. And you just kept saying no, and no, and no, and no. So I'm going to let me come into your world as one of you. And I'm going to let you kill me as a demonstration of just how much I love you. I love you so much, I will let you kill me. And then after you've done that, I'm going to come back and say, see, it didn't work. How much more can you hate me? You've already killed me, and I'm still here. Recognize that I am the one I said I was. Recognize that I am the God that I've always said I was. I am the God of love. I am the God of compassion. I am the God who is slow to anger. I am the God that's going to rain grace upon you even when you don't deserve it. I am the God who's going to rain mercy down upon you even when you don't deserve it, because I love you. I am the God that's going to go through the cross. I am the God that's going to get spit on. I am the God that's going to be beaten and whipped. I am the God that's going to wear a crown of thorns. All to get you to recognize and understand I love you. Friday, which is what we're in right now, if you didn't know. We're in Friday right now. Next year, we're actually going to have a Good Friday service. I made that decision this week. Had a little bit too short notice to call people and say, hey, it's Tuesday, but Friday, we're going to have a Good Friday service. So I said, we'll do it next year. Friday is Good Friday, because Friday is the day that Jesus said the ultimate, I love you, by surrendering his life on the cross. One of my most favorite things about the movie The Shack, and I haven't talked about it in weeks, I'm trying not to talk about it as much. But when you see God, she has the scars on her wrist too. Jesus was not alone on the cross. Not only was she or he on the cross with him, but according to Romans 6, every single one of us who has put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ was on that cross too. We all carry the scars of sin, and we all carry the scars of the forgiveness of our sins. Our constant reminders. And I know people, it's been a thing recently where people are starting to get scars tattooed on their wrists to remind them of the ultimate show of love and their participation in it. That cross was not alone. It must have been a really strong tree. What's that tree that they, there was the one president, they said he's old, was it old hickory? And hickory was like the really strong wood that wouldn't break, right? Hickory's, I'm looking at Milo and Jeff, because they know their wood. That tree must have been made out of hickory, because there was a whole lot of weight, just with myself, on that cross, okay? And it didn't break. It held it all. And Jesus cried out. Once, because imagine, once all of us came and got on that cross with him, that's when he said, now it's finished. It's finished. All of your sin, any sin that you ever committed, any sin that you're committing right now, sinners saying, what is this nonsense Jimmy's talking about? You're sinning. And any sin that you're going to commit in the future was all put to death right then and there when Jesus said, it is finished. His life isn't finished. The penalty of sin in your life is finished. Amen.